The Silent Hill series would not be what it is today, or rather what it was in 2004, if it weren't for the multitude of books, movies, and works of art that came before it. When Team Silent made these games, they were basically inventing their own branch of the psychological horror genre, and in order to do it, they studied an extensive collection of works by masters in the fields of horror storytelling and filmmaking.
What we want to do is give you the very first comprehensive video guide to Silent Hill's influences. We'll be outlining and summarizing the series' biggest inspirations, as well as attempting to explain why these works might have been important to the production of the games.
A common mistake people make when looking at Silent Hill's influences is that they reduce them to nothing more than a list of works that Silent Hill's creators referenced a bunch of times and leave it at that.
Isn't that exactly what we're going to be doing?
Maybe to the untrained brain, it's more than that. Everywhere you look, you see people desperately trying to squeeze every last possible reference out of the films, books, and artwork that Team Silent members have mentioned. This was taken from this, that was taken from that, while missing the greater reasoning behind Team Silent's actions. Of course, you can find a multitude of allusions and homages in the games, but Silent Hill's creators were using the influential works for more than just pop culture references.
I want the consumer to not look at Silent Hill 2 on the surface, rather I want them to look a little deeper. It's easy to say that this is a story with certain facts. I want the player to question, why did the creators do this or that? Or why did James or Maria react that way? This is a game where the questioning needs to be deeper to appreciate the real underlying story.
You'll notice that the bulk of the movies, books, and other media cited by Team Silent are Western works of art. Why? Simply put, their goal was to make a Western horror game, but they realized that as Japanese people, their cultural differences kept them from understanding how Western horror worked, so they were giving themselves a crash course in Western horror and culture.
The original Silent Hill was our attempt at making classic American horror through a Japanese filter.
The Lost Memories portion of the Silent Hill 3 official guidebook complete contains a list of influential works across a wide array of mediums. As this subject tends to be highly speculative, our focus will be on the pieces that are listed there, as well as pieces mentioned by Team Silent members in interviews or otherwise. We'll also be looking at influences that were not explicitly mentioned by Team Silent, but are either obvious enough that they don't need a citation or can be inferred through relation to cited authors, directors, or artists.
However, we want to be careful with any influential work that isn't confirmed by the creators or another official source. There are many lists of influences and references on the internet compiled by fans containing entries that seem obvious, but few of these have any kind of official confirmation. For example, the Silent Hill Wiki, which has the rather annoying characteristic of being utterly citationless, whenever possible, has an extensive list of Silent Hill inspirations.
The page does consist almost exclusively of works listed in Lost Memories, with a couple of plausible extras cited from interviews and found by fans. But in September of 2009, the films Solaris and Fantasma di Amore suddenly appeared and have stayed there ever since. The only references to these two movies we could find in relation to the Silent Hill series before they were added to the wiki were from posts in the Silent Hill Heaven forums in threads full of people talking about movies they think have an uncanny resemblance to Silent Hill 2, with no official sources cited. The practice of comparing Silent Hill to any random horror movie and claiming it's an inspiration is so common on internet forums that the phrase, "Oh, that's just like Silent Hill," has become a running joke every time we're watching a movie.
Don't get us wrong, there's nothing wrong with finding and discussing parallels to Silent Hill in other works, and there's nothing that says Solaris or Phantasma weren't inspirations for Silent Hill. But it's very easy to confuse things that are uncannily similar to Silent Hill for things that were directly inspirational, and it's all fun and games until it gets added to the Silent Hill wiki and presented as fact.
Isn't it funny that both of these films, which share the dead wife coming back to life characteristic with Silent Hill 2, are mentioned without official citation? And yet Alfred Hitchcock used the same plot device in Vertigo, and Vertigo isn't mentioned as an inspiration anywhere, let alone the Silent Hill wiki, despite a citation of Hitchcock's work making it a much more likely source of inspiration for James's doppelganger wife than the other two.
Bottom line, coincidence is not confirmation. Tropes is tropes. Anything that isn't obvious or not cited, even things you see in this video, should not be taken as gospel.
Team Silent's primary goal with Silent Hill was to tell a good story and shake up your heart while doing it. They looked to some of the world's top authors to learn what separates a good horror tale from a bad one.
One of the largest contributors to Team Silent's collection of literary inspirations is Stephen King. King has become so widely recognized as a master of the horror genre that most of his writing has been adapted for film and television. Many of his novels are set in Maine, the state in which he was born and currently lives, and this is more than likely the reason Team Silent chose Maine as the setting for Silent Hill.
In his book about horror fiction, Danse Macabre, Stephen King describes three different types of horror: terror, horror, and revulsion. While horror and revulsion are visceral reactions to monsters jumping out or aliens bursting from chests or blood and guts, terror is the psychological effect we feel when imagining the horrors to come. It's the psychological terror of Stephen King's books that Team Silent is picking up on.
I recognize terror as the finest emotion, and so I will try to terrorize the reader. But if I find I cannot terrify him or her, I will try to horrify. And if I find I cannot horrify, I'll go for the gross out. I'm not proud.
Luckily, Team Silent has no problem maintaining the psychological effects of terror even after the horror has been revealed. The way King does it is much the same as the way Team Silent does it. By recognizing the true horror plays on people's inner fears.
Shaking people's heart deeply.
But that's not all Team Silent got from Stephen King's books. It seems like every third or fourth story he writes is about a kid with psychic powers, or a parallel universe, or the mystery of an abandoned town, or a combination of the three. For example, The Regulators is about an autistic boy who acquires the power to control reality from a demon. He uses this power to transform his neighborhood, and his manifestations attack his neighbors. This novel has a sister novel called Desperation that depicts an alternate reality, with doubles of all the characters from The Regulators. In Desperation, the very same demon is in control of a small desert town, where it has killed all of the residents.
Well, go ahead and pray. See what good it does. But God ain't here. Any more than he was when Jesus was dying on the cross with flies in his eyes. Jack!
Children of the Corn is about a married couple that ends up in an abandoned town where every building is run down except for the church, where a cult of children sacrifices adults to a demonic creature that lives in the cornfields surrounding the town.
What is this? These people all died so young.
Not die. We go to him. Yeah. The first night of our 19th year.
Who the hell's him?
He who walks behind the rose.
It is said that the pinball machine in Silent Hill's cafe is a reference to the pinball machine in the movie version of Children of the Corn, which is very plausible. However, it should be noted that the one in Silent Hill is a medieval madness machine, while the one in the film is a Medusa machine.
You shit on my house!
The most famous example, The Shining, is about the Torrance family moving into the Overlook Hotel as its new caretakers.
You would never hurt Mommy or me, would you?
Danny Torrance happens to be a boy with psychic powers referred to as the Shining, and allows him to see visions and communicate with the spirits that inhabit the old hotel.
You know, Doc, when something happens, it can leave a trace of itself behind. Things that people who shine can see.
The novel ends with Danny telepathically predicting the explosion of the boiler in the hotel's basement.
Wait, what happened to the hotel?
A boiler explosion.
A boiler explosion?
Yeah, the boiler exploded.
And how did we find out this was going to happen?
Danny's telepathic powers.
Telepathic powers?
That's what I said, mind powers.
Telepathic powers and a boiler explosion? Are you sure we're not talking about Silent Hill?
No, this is The Shining. How do telepathic powers and a boiler explosion have anything to do with Silent Hill?
Oh. It's not like Silent Hill at all, is it? I guess you're right. Never mind.
Among the stories Stephen King has written that are specifically mentioned by Team Silent members are The Mist, Carrie, Pet Sematary, The Langoliers, and It. These are the works by Stephen King that most influenced the making of the Silent Hill games. Carrie is the story of a young girl with psychic powers who is tormented relentlessly by her schoolmates. She lives an extremely sheltered life with her mother, a religious fanatic who broke from the church and preaches her own crazy religion. Two of Carrie's classmates, Tommy and Sue, take pity on her, and Tommy invites Carrie to the prom.
If you don't have a date for the prom next Friday, would you like to go with me?
As you might already know, it don't end well. Stephen King's Carrie is most likely where Team Silent got the inspiration for Alessa's psychic powers, and the relationship between Dahlia and her daughter.
It is about a nameless otherworldly entity that feeds on humans.
I am eternal child. I am the eater of worlds and of children.
It can reach into a person's mind and manifest itself as anything it finds there.
You ever had. I am your worst dream come true. I'm everything you ever were afraid of.
The manifestation of inner fear is all the spiritual power of Silent Hill does after the events of the first game.
You're not real! You're not real!
Mm-hmm.
As for the origin of that power, it might be attributed to Pet Sematary, which is about a cemetery in a small town where children bury their dead pets. The cemetery happens to be located near old Indian burial grounds, and any living thing buried there returns to life as an evil killing machine.
The person you put up there ain't the person that comes back. It may look like that person, but it ain't that person. Because whatever lives in the ground beyond the Pet Sematary ain't human at all.
The area was a sacred place to the northeastern Mi'kmaq tribe.
You know what I heard?
And it is implied that they stopped burying their dead on the grounds because they had buried people who were possessed by the spirit of the Wendigo, a spirit of madness and cannibalism. The Wendigo permanently tainted the spiritual power of the burial grounds, which is exactly what happens to the spiritual power of Silent Hill as the result of the cult's attempt to summon the demon Samael. Lewis and Rachel Creed move into a house near the grounds, and their new neighbor Judd shows Lewis the power of the burial grounds when the Creed's cat is killed.
Christ. I don't believe this. Oh, you stink, Church.
It is suggested that the evil power of the burial grounds is responsible for the death of their son, Gage, so that Lewis would bury Gage there and the evil could enter his body. Lewis buries his son on the grounds, his son comes back to life and murders Judd and Rachel Creed, and Lewis kills him once again. At the end, under the influence of dark forces, he carries his wife to the grounds, intending to resurrect her, which is mirrored in Silent Hill 2's rebirth ending. In the film version, recommended by Hiroyuki Owaku, Lewis and Rachel are haunted by visions of death and decay. The film made such an impact on Owaku that the names of the actors for the Creeds, Dale Midkiff and Denise Crosby, appear in a memo in Silent Hill 3.
The Mist tells the story of people who become trapped in a supermarket when mysterious monster-filled fog rolls into town.
Something in the mist! Something in the mist! Damn. Cook John Lee! Damn.
Two of the trapped citizens are Marines from the nearby military base, who explain that the fog and monsters may have something to do with Project Arrowhead, the US military's experiment in opening portals to other universes.
The Schwicky states that in Silent Hill, a pterosaur-like creature crashes through a diner window, as in The Mist. This is certainly a plausible connection to the air screamers of Silent Hill 1, but the creature in The Mist only crashes through the window in the 2007 film adaptation. In the book, the creature crawls through a pre-existing hole in the glass. However, the description of the creature that follows may have inspired Team Silent to go looking for the paintings of pterodactyls you may have seen in the dinosaur books, which could explain how Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's The Lost World became one of Alessa's favorite books, since the air screamers are manifested from its pterodactyl illustrations. But that's all very speculatory.
And believable.
And we're not supposed to be doing that.
Toward the end of the book, the main character leaves a notebook detailing the events of what he's been through for someone to find in the future, on the counter of a diner. What he writes is almost exactly what Harry writes when he first saved the game in the cafe at the beginning of Silent Hill 1. We might call that a coincidence if it weren't for Stephen King's "Study Damn It!" poster that's basically on screen when the message is displayed.
The Schwicky also draws a parallel between Silent Hill and the static that comes from every radio in The Mist, which is plausible. But we think Silent Hill's monster-tracking radio static concept has a higher plausibility of coming from the Owaku-recommended TV miniseries adaptation of Stephen King's The Langoliers, in which dry, papery sounds like radio static get louder and louder as monsters approach.
The sound I told you about before. I can hear it again. It's getting closer. Much, much closer.
The Langoliers is about a plane full of people that fall asleep and wake up mid-flight to discover that their plane is abandoned.
Where is everybody? They've gone, they've all gone!
What do you mean, where's everybody? They're all right here.
Later they land the plane to find out that the airport and the rest of the world is also abandoned and they seem to be the only people left on Earth. With them is a blind girl who is psychic, can read people's minds and see through their eyes.
I hear things sometimes. People's thoughts. I always have.
When she sees through the eyes of Craig Toomey, the severely emotionally disturbed businessman played by Tom Hewlett, she discovers that he sees all the other passengers as monsters.
We all look like monsters to him.
Okay.
This just might be another inspiration for Vincent's joke in Silent Hill 3.
They look like monsters to you?
Near the end of The Langoliers, we get to see Tom Hewlett's last business meeting with Konami before his separation with the company.
Give us your report. Tell us how much money you made for us.
I didn't make any money for you. I didn't make any money for you. I lost money for you. I lost money for you. I lost $43 million, and I did it deliberately! I did it deliberately! I did it deliberately!
Like Stephen King, Dean Koontz and his coconut hair are another recognized author that has greatly influenced the creation of Silent Hill. His books, written under 200 pen names, have been major bestsellers across the world. Although he began as a science fiction writer, he later turned to horror and suspense, for which he's best known. Dean Koontz may have written a smaller number of influential works than Stephen King, but the ones Team Silent did take inspiration from had just as big an impact on Silent Hill. In Phantoms, Jennifer and her sister Lisa drive into the small resort town of Snowfield to find that it's been abandoned, populated only by strange creatures, the bodies of their victims, and a few police officers. None of them are able to leave the town for help. A mysterious message written on a mirror prompts the survivors of this nightmare to contact Timothy Flight, author of The Ancient Enemy, an article that explains that what happened to the town is the same thing that's been happening to all mysteriously abandoned towns throughout history. An ancient creature has eaten and absorbed all of the town's citizens, and in doing so, acquired their knowledge. It thinks itself a god and can manifest itself as people it's absorbed, as well as anything those people may have imagined, including and especially their worst fears.
Just what is this thing?
Chaos. Chaos in the flesh.
The Door to December is a horror mystery novel about a young girl, Melanie, who was kidnapped by her father and goes missing for 6 years. After her father and the two men he was working with are discovered brutally murdered, Melanie is found wandering the streets of LA, barely functional and nearly catatonic. An investigation and hypnotherapy eventually reveal that the girl was kept in a room and subjected to occult experiments intended to awaken latent psychic powers, specifically astral projection. The book's account of a young girl being tortured to the point of splitting herself from her physical body parallels Alessa's experiences before Silent Hill 1. The book even compares this phenomenon to poltergeists, like the book Harry finds in the Midwich Elementary School library.
A lesser-known author than King or Koontz, Robert McCammon was nonetheless highly regarded as a horror writer in the 80s. Team Silent drew inspiration from his 1988 novel Stinger, but there's nothing about the book that immediately jumps out as being particularly Silent Hill-esque. It's about a small town where an alien crash lands while running from another alien bounty hunter called Stinger, who places a giant force field over the town so nobody can escape while it hunts for the first alien. Stinger burrows under the town in tunnels, popping up to abduct people and taking them back to its ship to transform them into monstrous drones under its control. You might say the description of Stinger's chop shop, located in a labyrinth of soggy leather tunnels filled with goop, sounds similar to Pyramid Head's little chamber in Silent Hill 2's labyrinth area. That's as close as we can get with this one.
Silent Hill may be a horror series, but in the case of Silent Hill 2, Team Silent merged horror with drama and dealt with deeper themes of human emotion. Takayoshi Sato states that the basic storyline of Silent Hill 2 was based on Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, in which Rodion Raskolnikov commits a murder to test his theory that some people are above the law and common morality. These people are extraordinary, above the ordinary man, and can kill people to the benefit of mankind with impunity.
Well, extraordinary men have a right to transgress the law because they're extraordinary, is that right?
Not exactly. I maintain such a man should not be judged by ordinary standards. For example, Napoleon. A man may wipe out millions of lives, but if he builds an empire, no one condemns him.
Raskolnikov murders a pawnbroker, a woman he considers a louse who cheats the poor out of their money, and steals that money in the interest of doing better with it. It's not long before guilt takes over, and his idea of the extraordinary man becomes an excuse, his way of alienating himself and living in his own world where he doesn't have to feel bad because he's not guilty of anything.
You know, you're the first of our clients who has come here voluntarily.
Perhaps the others are all afraid to.
Except for you, not a Napoleon in the whole outfit.
Two other characters in the book, a police detective and a hooker, both know Rasko is guilty, but the detective can't prove it and the hooker is in love with him and won't turn him in. So both of them talk openly about the murder with Rasko in an attempt to get him to confess. But like James Sunderland, the old rascal must admit it to himself before he can find redemption.
It's well known that the street names in Silent Hill games are named for famous authors, and these are all listed in Lost Memories. It's unclear whether Team Silent were taking inspiration from these authors or merely paying tribute, but we'd like to point out a few that are of particular significance. Levin Street is named after Ira Levin, author of Rosemary's Baby, which, just like Silent Hill, is about a satanic cult that's trying to impregnate a woman with the seed of a demon.
Matheson Street is named after Richard Matheson. Lost Memories states that he's the author of Where There's a Will and Mr. Right. But we find another novel to be more important, Hell House, which is about a physicist, his wife, and two mediums that stay the night in a haunted house in order to discover its secrets. Matheson also wrote the screenplay for the film adaptation called The Legend of Hell House, in which one of the mediums looks nearly identical to Alessa. He's also cited by another author on this list, Stephen King, as being the author who most inspired him.
Sagan Street is named after Carl Sagan, astrophysicist, author of Contact, and an all-around happy guy. Contact tells the story of an alien race that challenges humanity to build a device that can transport people billions and billions of light years away, where the aliens communicate with them by manifesting as dead people from their pasts, drawn directly from their minds, like Silent Hill can do.
None of this is real. When I was unconscious, you downloaded my thoughts, my memories even.
We thought this might make things easier for you.
And finally, Midwich Street is named for the town from Village of the Damned, the film adaptation of The Midwich Cuckoos by John Wyndham. It's the story of a small town where an extraterrestrial object impregnates all the women in town with alien babies. The demonic alien children grow at an alarming rate and possess the power to read and control minds. It's fitting that the story of evil children is also the source of the name for Silent Hill's Midwich Elementary School.
Even though Team Silent's primary focus was on creating an approximation of Western horror, they could still draw inspiration from the literature of their home country. Kunio Yanagita was a scholar who traveled the Japanese countryside collecting Japanese folktales, beliefs, and customs, and compiled them in a book called Tono Monogatari, or Legends of Tono. The stories in this book are transcripts of stories of everyday life for rural Japanese people as well as their mythology.
From this work, the traditions of Silent Hill reference the way prosaic folk traditions should be and their placement.
From the straightforward, unembellished tone of these stories, it's easy to see how they influenced the way Owaku wrote the books and memos in the Silent Hill series, particularly those that relate to the town's background information and local legends.
Hiroyuki Owaku cites the work of Masako Bando as inspiration for the game's oppressive atmosphere.
Bando has a superb style that possesses a musty atmosphere and a viscous feeling of oppression. I made a great effort to work that sense of atmosphere into the game.
According to booksfromjapan.jp, Bando recasts old Japanese customs, traditions, and folklore into contemporary tales, bringing freshness to a genre dominated by the influence of Western horror films. Since most of Bando's novels have yet to be translated to English and she's relatively unknown, we'll just have to take Owaku's word for it. Deal with it.
Many people cite director David Lynch's frequent use of red curtains as the inspiration for the opening shot of Silent Hill 3, where two pairs of legs hang down from behind red curtains. However, Masahiro Ito tweeted that the intention was to use the image of red skirts blowing in the wind to represent an ill omen, creating a feeling of insecurity or restlessness, and his inspiration was a description in a novel by Kobo Abe called The Boxman. It's an absurd and surreal book about people who choose to live their lives inside cardboard boxes. These passages from the book describe what boxmen look like, covered from head to waist in a box, with canvas hanging from the bottom so that only their legs are visible. The main character of the novel encounters another person that he terms a fake boxman, someone who is a copy of himself, which is coincidentally not unlike the relationship between Heather and Alessa.
In an interview before the launch of Silent Hill 4 in North America, Masashi Tsubuyama talked about how they got the idea for the game's story.
For the scenario, we got our general influence from a book called Coin Locker Babies, which was written by a Japanese writer called Ryu Murakami. It talks about a baby abandoned in a coin locker. That was the general background.
The novel as a whole doesn't have much to do with Silent Hill 4, but a few elements made their way into Walter's backstory. Coin Locker Babies follows the misadventures of two boys whose mothers abandon them in coin lockers as babies. They grow up having different, yet equally tragic and destructive lives. Like Walter, the boys are initially taken to an orphanage and involved in religious practices. They're also given therapy in a padded room with a simulated mother's heartbeat. The boys end up setting off on a quest to find and destroy the women that brought them into the world so cruelly, filling their lives with every kind of degrading activity you can think of along the way. In the end, it's a dark commentary on what it's like growing up as a troubled child.
Daijiro Motohoshi is a manga author whose work has yet to be translated. As a result, he's mostly unknown outside of Japan. Motohoshi's work consists of sci-fi, horror, and mystery comics that make heavy use of Japanese folklore. For example, in Tenjin-sama, the gate to a shadow zone filled with forgotten deities is unlocked by a children's song inspired by the Miyoshino Shrine north of Tokyo. This story of resurrecting the old gods and incorporating children's stories might be an inspiration for Silent Hill, as well as another Motohoshi work called Shadow Town, where a boy escapes into an alternate reality where his darkest fantasies come true, with real-world consequences. The Motohoshi comic Lost Memory cites is Shiori and Shimiko's incident involving a freshly severed head. In this story, two high school-aged girls discover the head of a man whose body parts are being found all over a local park. They take the head home and care for it like a pet fish for a short while, then release it into a stream where it swims away happily. this specific story doesn't have much relation to Silent Hill. Rather, it's probably because it's the name of the first volume in a comedic horror series about Shiori and Shimiko, who regularly get involved with ghosts, monsters, strange occurrences, cultists summoning demons, and portals to hell.
The second volume of the Shiori and Shimiko series, titled Blue Horses, contains the eponymous story where the girls follow some blue horses into a thick fog that ends up being a portal to a demon world. This story is much more like Silent Hill than the Severed Head incident, though that isn't saying Team Silent couldn't have been inspired by the Severed Head.
As one of the most popular horror manga writers in Japan, Junji Ito's influence on Silent Hill is to be expected. Specifically mentioned in Lost Memories is his horror manga collection Volume 11, The Town Without Streets. It contains 5 short stories, 3 of which share similarities with Silent Hill. In the titular story, The Town Without Streets, a young girl has a dream where a killer murders one of her schoolmates. The next day, she finds out that her dream has become reality.
Damn, she's got numbers carved into her chest.
She later flees her home after her family begins spying on her through holes in the walls and acting strangely.
Where did I put that damn broom?
She travels to a distant town to stay with her aunt, but finds it overwhelmed by strange buildings that mysteriously appear overnight in continuous, almost impossible architecture, making the streets disappear. The townsfolk have given up their privacy in order to get around the labyrinth, driving them mad. The girl soon finds the town to be a hostile maze that she must escape, host to strange beings that don't even look human, and the real-life killer from her dreams.
The second story, titled Map Town, is about a couple on their honeymoon who wanders into a strange town covered in maps and signposts. The locals tell them that the town has a strange power to make people lose their sense of direction, seemingly the work of malevolent forest spirits. Despite their skepticism, they end up succumbing to the power of the town and getting lost, ending with one of them disappearing altogether.
Lastly, there's a story called Village of the Siren, in which a local village official breaks into a church and releases a demon locked in the basement. 2 months later, hundreds of babies are reported to be abducted across Japan. A young man travels to the village to visit his family and finds the village has been sacrificing babies to summon a demon. A horrific siren made by the demons has been driving everyone in town crazy. It comes at dusk, putting everyone who doesn't cover their ears under mind control and turning women into flying devils. Ultimately, a giant demon is summoned and takes over Japan with an army of winged women folk.
Although technically motifs rather than inspirations, Silent Hill is full of references to children's stories and literature, such as The Wizard of Oz, Alice in Wonderland, and fairy tales by the Brothers Grimm. These are mostly used for puzzle themes and are present throughout the series due to their strong connection with Alessa. Uwaku explains.
The other world in the first game is a world manifested from the depths of Alessa's consciousness. The reason why many items and solutions to riddles that originate from works like Alice in Wonderland and The Wizard of Oz appear is that these are Alessa's favorite books from her childhood. Also, Alice and Oz are both stories about young girls who lose their way in an other world.
The works of William Shakespeare are another literary motif, infamous for Silent Hill 3's hard difficulty bookstore puzzle, which requires you to have at least a cursory knowledge of some of Shakespeare's tragedies. On a nearby bookbinding, opposite the complete works of Oscar Wilde, is a painting of Macbeth and Lady Macbeth in an embrace. Macbeth is perhaps more significant to Silent Hill than Team Silent knows, as the plot has been compared to Crime and Punishment by noted Russian author Boris Pasternak, which is a fun name to say.
Neither Macbeth or Raskolnikov is a born criminal or a villain by nature. They are turned into criminals by faulty rationalizations, by deductions from false premises.
The Macbeth painting is on the binding of a book titled The 57th Street Bridge Song, which is a groovy choice for whoever titled it. Hiroyuki Owako explains how Shakespeare's tragedies fit into Silent Hill's narrative.
The expression of emotion is particularly strong in Macbeth. Also, if one consults the book, one can read the line, "An existence completely forgotten after it has ended," which expresses reality for the game's characters.
Silent Hill 3 also features an endgame puzzle with a tarot card motif. This puzzle uses 4 of the 5 cards from the Major Arcana, or original set of 22 trumps, with a 5th card that's a Hiroyuki original. To explain this last card, Heather finds a book about tarot in the cult's library, which mentions a gardener deck that contains more than the 22 trump cards. This could be a reference to the RG deck produced by Richard Gardner, though the real deck is just a reprint of an older deck by Insight Institute and does not contain any extra cards. So beyond the name, there's really no significant connection. Some people have speculated that the in-game deck might actually be a reference to Gerald Gardner, the father of Wicca, but the existence of a real Gardner deck makes this less likely.
End of part 16A. To continue, please insert the tape marked The Real Silent Hill Experience, part 16B, and the corresponding slide reel.